Greetings. I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about a few of the areas in the crime of all crimes toward a criminology of genocide, Professor Nicole Rafter's book that we're using in the course. And what I wanted to do is just spend a few minutes talking about the comparative analysis that she uses and what a successful model it really is for us in the criminal justice field. And so one of the reasons why I selected this textbook was because of the comparative analysis model. First, in Chapter 1, Genocide, Criminology, and the Evolution of Crimes of Crimes, there's some discussion about the nature of genocide. For example, Dr. Rafter points out that genocide is changing, that we see some changes going on there. And we see more sexual assaults, for example, more ethnic conflict, more recognition worldwide that there's a problem, genocides occurring within civil wars, and so on. And we also see that the responses are changing, and we'll see in the course that we do get some exposure to some of the international tribunals, for example, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia and the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. And additionally, we see that the International Criminal Court also has a role to play in prosecuting genocide perpetrators. And she points out that the study of genocide is changing, that we've moved maybe more to a micro focus, although there's still a lot of meso and macro research going on. And we also have new types of research, obviously satellite photography used to trace the patterns and effects of genocide have been clearly demonstrated in the recent years. She takes a criminological approach to 8 genocides, which she selected, and then developed case study questions and then used qualitative analysis software in vivo to compare the cases on a variety of factors. And the time frame she selected was 1900 to 2000. So basically she has a non-probability purposive sample, and she uses a thematic comparative analysis method that looks at the macro or large-scale structural factors, the meso or group organizational structures, and the micro or individual levels, and of course the interaction between those. And that's something that comes up in a lot of genocide research where, you know, we're asked, well, should we focus on the big, large macro structural aspects like the government, the educational system, the medical institution, the military, or should we focus on micro? Small groups interacting in different locations, or the meso, which kind of is in between, maybe organizations, different groups, and the like. I think you can do all that. So in Chapter 2, What Kind of Crime is Genocide? Professor Rafter talks about some of her preliminary findings and the profiles of the perpetrators and the victims, and begins to ask some questions on who creates genocide, who's in charge, what kind of crime is genocide actually classified as, and she also states that it's similar to ordinary violent crime but at a much greater magnitude with multiple types of violence, as we'll see throughout the semester, and again emphasizing the comparative method being used to look at the macro, meso, micro similarities and differences across these 8 genocides. Now, skipping all the way over to the Appendix B, Case Study Questions, she looks at the stages and some of the questions we can ask in those stages. And that is a model for comparative analysis. And we'll see some other models as well throughout this semester, but she has provided us with an excellent model there. Stage 1, the prior history of tension between the genocidal and victim groups, really asks, is there a history of violence? Stage 2, social instability in the genocidal group or state. Is there social instability in perpetrator groups or the state? And stage three, the dehumanization of the victim. So here she asks, how are the victims dehumanized? In stage four, mobilization for the genocide. In other words, how do the perpetrators get together and organize to create and carry out the genocide? Stage five is the triggering event and victim vulnerability, focusing on how the genocides actually begin. And stage six, extermination, neutralization of guilt, looks at, and denial looks at how the genocides are achieved, and focusing on both the physical as well as the psychological and sociological aspects. In other words, there is some neutralization going on among the perpetrator groups, how they account for their behaviors and what they're doing. And then stage seven is the termination and aftermaths. How do the genocides end? And she also asks, do they end? So what we see sometimes, it seems like genocides may increase in intensity, and then we see a decrease in the genocidal behavior, only to be followed up maybe years later by a second genocide or even a third genocide. And so this whole model looks at the genocidal process as a dynamic aspect. And how it evolves and how it changes over time. And certainly we'll see that with those cases as she compares and contrasts on a variety of factors. I think the big tip that I like to point out is that when you're conducting a comparative analysis, focus on something very, very specific. For example, I've been working on some research recently looking at sexual abuse during three genocides, the Balkans, the Rwandan, and the Holocaust, and comparing and contrasting how sexual abuse occurred, how frequently, what types, what were the reactions, and how did the legal system intervene, if it did, and how did the world react. And so there's a lot of different areas that we could address in that regard. And later on, I'll show you my own comparative analysis using violentization theory to look at how perpetrators become, or individuals, I should say, become genocidal perpetrators. And I compare and contrast cases within a genocide and across several genocides. And this wraps up this video, and I apologize for any background noise that might have occurred, that are two very active cats running around. In fact, I got one here. All right.